Hey everyone, welcome back to the North Dakota Teaching Podcast. I'm so happy that you're here. As you know, we are going through a new series which is covering first-year teachers and their journey through their first year in the classroom. Today we have someone here who has a really unique teaching experience and I'm so excited for you to get to know her a little bit better. So again, thank you for being here and I will see you inside today's episode.
Welcome to the North Dakota Teaching Podcast. Whether you're a first-year teacher, veteran teacher, or just a mom trying to gain some new insights, you are right where you are meant to be. Kayla Durkin, founder of the Blossoming Teacher Course, is passionate about helping new teachers blossom into the teacher they were born to be. Kayla wants to help inspire teachers to be their best self, whether that means sharing about personal or professional development, self-care, or the latest and most effective teaching strategies. Through this podcast, you will hear from real teachers sharing their stories about teaching, all with one main goal in mind, to be able to make an impact and help other teachers blossom. And with that, here is your host, Kayla Durkin.
Hi everyone, welcome to today's episode. Today I have with me Irina Chavetz, and she has a really interesting teaching journey that I'm so excited for her to get a chance to share with you. She is seriously such a sweetheart, and I just cannot wait for you to learn from her. So without further ado, here is Irina. Hi Irina, how are you today?
I'm good, how are you?
Good, thank you. Why don't you just take a couple minutes to tell everyone this interesting teaching journey that you have?
Okay, so my journey began, like, I didn't know what I wanted to do in high school. Everybody kept asking me, like, what are you going to go for? I'm like, I'm just going to go to school, figure something out. I took two semesters. I said I was going to do, like, business, and then ended up, nope, didn't like it. And I had a few counselors. I reached out to Columbus State Community College. I reached out to them. I talked to some counselors. Told me to take a few personality tests and, like, career assessments. And then they're like, from there, we can help you, you know, figure out your career, like if you want to go that route or not. And then I went, took a few tests, and they're like, yeah, it looks like you're like, you like to be with kids and so and like so and so. And I was like, you know what? I do. I babysit a lot. And like, why not try this out and see if I like it or not? And I got into the early childhood program at CSCC. And I did that for 2 years there. And I did a lot of student teaching there. They place you into like different practicums and stuff. And after finishing there, I think after a summer off, I didn't work anywhere. My mentor at Columbus State, she referred me to this job where I work at right now. It's a preschool center in Bexley. And I've been there for 2 years. This is my third year, like starting my third year of having kids in my classroom. They're 3 years old. And I decided after having a year off, because I graduated 2018 fall, and I had a year off, and I'm like, you know what? I want to go a little bit higher. So now I'm getting my bachelor's at Ohio Dominican, and that will be probably in like 2022. But I plan to teach either kindergarten or first, and I have a whole variety. I can either do pre-K up to fifth grade. So I'm like, you know what? We'll see where that takes me.
That's so interesting. I love that journey. I feel like it's a unique journey because most people right away, they're like, I'll just do whatever it takes to get that 4-year degree. But I love how you said you weren't quite sure what you wanted to go into. So they had you take some personality tests. And from there, they said, oh, hey, you would fit perfect. So from taking that personality test to now being with your preschoolers for almost 3 years, do you feel like it was a good choice?
It sure was. Like, even I look at it now, like in my classes I'm taking at Ohio Dominican, we did a few of those personality tests again. And I was like, oh, I've done this before. And I'm like, I love where I'm at. I love my job. And I'll be there until I'm able to get my bachelor's and, you know, get into a public school or and find a grade that I love to teach.
So tell us a little bit about this preschool. Are you the lead teacher? Is there other people in the classroom with you? How does it work? How many kids do you have?
Okay, so the past 2 years, we've always had three teachers in my classroom. Due to COVID, things changed. And when we had three teachers in the classroom, we would start with 16 kids in our classroom. And then after everyone was three, we would get like four more kids added. So a total of 20 kids in our classroom. And with COVID happening and the whole pandemic, we were shut down from March up until September. And we just opened back up and we have split. My whole classroom that I had was a really big classroom. So we split it in half and I got one half of the classroom and another teacher got the other half. And right now it's me in there and I have 6 students. So it's like 1 to 6. We have really small ratios, which is really nice because you can like be on one-on-one with a lot of those kids in the classroom, unlike 16 kids, and to teach other teachers, it's kind of tough. So I'm like, for me, this has given me a chance to see, like, I know it's only 6 kids, but it's giving me a chance to see what it's going to be like when I get into my own classroom. I'll be by myself. Like, you don't get those restroom breaks as often as you think you'd get, or you don't get to step out. And like when you have 2 other teachers in there, you can step out and go print something real quick. Here it's like making sure you have your lesson plans, you know, prep by Monday, your materials and everything like that.
I love how you brought that up because technically it's not your first year of teaching, but technically it's kind of like your first year of teaching because this is the first time you've been in it on your own.
Oh yeah. I'm like, when I signed up for this, I was like, wait a second. I'm like, I'm technically not in a like public school yet. I'm like, I'm still just doing preschool. Mm-hmm. And it's just, you know, giving me more experience to when I do become a teacher in a public school.
Oh, definitely. So let's hear a little bit more about the journey that you have. What classes are you in right now? What do you have left to do to finish your degree?
So I just, last year in fall 2019, I decided I want to go back. And it was just like spontaneous. Like, you know what? I've talked a few of parents I babysit for. They were like, they're teachers. And they're like, do you want to be stuck at a preschool your whole life? Or do you want to go further? I was like, well, I've always wanted to go further. But I just ended up at a preschool. And I'm like, I love it. But I'm like, yes, I do want to go on. And I want to be able to, you know, I loved second grade when I was, that's how I got inspired to become a teacher. And I was like, maybe I'll teach second grade. But I really like the first kindergarten level because I feel like it's closer to preschool for me. And like, so I'll start there and we'll go from there. But so I took a few classes at Columbus State before I could transfer over. Because they're like, you have 4 more classes you can take before you transfer. I'm like, sure, I'll take those. And so I just started at ODU this fall. I'm taking 4 classes. They're all like, 3 of them are education courses, like the first level. And right now I'm applying to get into the education program for spring semester.
That's so really exciting.
I am prepping for my practice exams.
Oh my God.
I'm like, okay, busy schedule, but you know, got to make it work.
So I have multiple things I want to bring up about that. But before I forget, how many hours a day are you working, right? Is it full time?
I'm almost full time. I don't go on Tuesdays and Thursday mornings until like after 11 because I have college and I do virtual online. So I'm not done until 11 o'clock. So I'll come to work at 11:30. So I get at least 34 hours a week of teaching the kids and then full time college.
Wow. So I still have questions I want to back up to, but how do you balance all of that?
It's like I have a calendar in my room, I have a agenda book, and I have reminders on my phone. It's just like constantly checking every day, like, is there any new updates from professors? Is there any new assignments due? Like, it's before I even have a class, I'm like checking if I made sure I did everything and, you know, not miss anything. It's hard because, like, you know, I kind of want to still have a social life, but then at the same time, you kind of have to give up some of it up, but I'm managing.
Right. You have to give a little to get a little. And so in this case, you're trying to work full time, you're trying to go to school full time. So something has to give so that you can just have your sanity, I guess. I mean, you're giving out every single direction. So would you say there's one strategy for anyone else who's trying to balance finishing their degree, probably working at the same time? What is the best strategy or tip that you have for them to balance all of that?
Well, for me, it's like, I can't do anything at home. Like if I come home, I sit at my bed, I'll pass out. I'm like, I'm not doing anything. So I try to like go to like coffee shops that are not too loud, you know, put my AirPods in and sit down, like start working on it. And like, I also like to make a to-do list. Like these are the things I know I can get done today. Let me get those done today. And like, and then what a lot of people have told me before, like make a to-do list that you can actually get done. Don't just put things on there that you're like, oh, I need that and that and that. Like, well, will you be able to actually get everything done? So like, you know, the top five things I need to get done today, like go through, like, did I finish this assignment for this class? Did I do that chapter reading? Did I finish this? Or like the things that are due the soonest, work on those first and just finding like a place, quiet place to study. Like I used to go to the library all the time, reserve a room for like 4 hours, knock out what I can. But right now with COVID, it's like you can't really get in as much. So it's like finding something else, another place for me to be able to do that.
I love that. I love that you know what works for you. And I love that you are prioritizing things. And just like you said, you're not being unrealistic because, I mean, for me, here, I have one right here. I make checklists every single day, just like you. And some of the things that I put on my list, I'm like, am I actually going to get that done? Probably not. But I just put it on there as a visual reminder. And then it goes on to the next day's checklist. But I love how you're saying, what five things do I want to get done today? That's so awesome. So I think that's a great tip for everyone who is listening. So if we back up a little bit, you were talking about your day in preschool and how you don't go until 11. Is that what you said?
Yeah, on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
So what happens with your class when you're not there?
I do have another teacher in my classroom on those 2 days. We like kind of co-teach in a way. Like I will make the lesson plan and I will ask her what does she want to do on Tuesday and Thursday since she has to do like a circle group, a learning time or art activity with them. And so like this week we're doing like autumn, like just fall in general, like leaves and those kind of things. And we did that last week as well, but we didn't get everything done from last week. So we're just moving it to this week as well. And we've done so many different things with like paintings and pumpkins and whatnot. So she picks the things that she wants to do on Tuesday and Thursday. She still follows the whole routine. It's just that the things are easier for her to do when she's there on those days. And then when I'm there Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I'll pick things that I wanted to do with the kids.
That's awesome. That's great. So it's kind of like you're already making sub plans, which is something you're definitely going to have to do when you accept a job in a public school. So how do you feel like your role right now working in this preschool is preparing you to accept a job in a public school?
Well, sometimes the teacher that I have in my classroom on Tuesdays and Thursdays, like she might get put into another classroom. So I have somebody else that doesn't know my routine. So it's like making sure I have a whole typed up plan, like step by step, like at 8 a.m. when they get in, they're going to do like they're going to go do their morning greeting, wash their hands, and then start, you know, morning circle. And this is what you do at morning circle. It's like I made sure to because this happened like a few weeks ago that I didn't have the other teacher in my room. And I was like, oh, boy, like, I didn't tell her what she's going to do in my room. And I'm like, she didn't pick the lesson plan, what she wants to teach or anything like that. So I'm like, okay, let me back up. I stayed after work a little bit that day, typed up a plan. And now that plan is in my binder. Like you can just check. It's like a simple plan, but it's step by step, like time by time. This is our transition time. This is where you call 5 minute cleanup. This is when we have snack, lunch. So, and later when I came in after 11, I was like, so how was the morning? She was like, your instructions were phenomenal. Like, I went through everything. She's like, I got everything done. It went well. And I was like, okay. I just need to make sure I have that written in my lesson plan book. And it'll be easier just to pull it open so you know you don't lose that loose leaf paper that's in the binder. But
right. What a gratifying moment for you to hear that it went really well, that your plans were on point, and that everything just flowed the way you wanted it to. Obviously, it's different when we can't be with our students in the classroom, but knowing that there's a sense of routine and that these kids are still able to do the things that they're used to is just going to help that substitute so much more because it's not such a chaotic time for them. Because when you have kids, especially young kids, preschoolers, trying to do whatever the sub is telling them to do and they're not used to doing it, it can cause a lot of frustration.
Oh, yeah, especially since they're all 3 years old and then if it's not the same person that they're used to in the classroom, it's like, good luck.
Right. No kidding. So I know at the beginning you mentioned you've wanted to be a teacher since you were in second grade. Will you tell us a little bit about that?
I had a teacher in second grade that like inspired me. She was just like, I am bilingual. I speak Ukrainian and English. And so I didn't know English as much when I was in her class yet. Like I was still learning because we speak Ukrainian at home. And so in her class, she went out of her way to make different, like, you know, adjustments for me, just to be able to, I can understand something and like pair me with people that would be able to help me learn better, like different visuals, different like techniques that just got me through second grade, even though like you would think it's easy, like just, oh, it's second grade, but not knowing English at all, or like knowing a little bit of it, she helped me a lot. And to this day, like, she's like, I've reached out to her and she's has been like, so how's your journey? Like, are you still in school? And like, she's like, let me know if you need a recommendation for anything. And it's like, wow, I can reach back out to my second grade teacher and be like, okay.
That just shows that teachers make an impact, not just for that year, but for a lifetime. Like, what year would you say second grade was? Are you able to even pinpoint it?
No, how old was I?
Maybe like 2005 or?
I graduated in 2015. Boy, I don't remember.
So anyway, maybe about 15 years ago, let's say. Are you like 21, 22?
I'm about to be 24 next week.
Okay, so maybe 15-ish years ago, we'll just go with. But that's still amazing that 15 years ago, your teacher did all these things for you to help you transition, to help you feel more comfortable. And now to this day, because of the things that she did for you, you want to do those for other people. So that kind of spins us off to tell us a little bit about being bilingual. Did you move here? Was your family, did they come here after you were born?
I was born in Ukraine, and my older brother, me, and my sister right after me, all three of us were born in Ukraine, and we moved to the United States when I was like 1.5. Okay. And my sister was like literally an infant still when we moved. We first moved to Chicago. We were there for like a year or so before we moved to Ohio. And then basically we grew up, most of the time I was just speaking, you know, Ukrainian at home. And it wasn't, you know, English, because my parents didn't know English. And so when we went to, when I started going to school is when I only started to learn English.
Okay.
I took a lot of like ESL classes to help me get through school.
Wow, that is amazing. And now your English is phenomenal. And what about your parents? Are they still only speaking Ukrainian, or do they speak any English?
They can speak English. They tend, like, they don't really want to, but if they are, my mom cleans houses. So when she goes and cleans houses, she'll talk to whoever's at the house. She'll like talk to them in English. She'll speak a few words here and there, but she understands English. Like if we talk to her in English, she'll understand. But for the most part, like, we try to talk to her in Ukrainian. We go to a Ukrainian church. So, like, you know, she has a lot of Ukrainian friends and whatnot.
Wow, that's amazing. That's really neat. So how do you think?
She also has taken English classes here that she went to, like, a few courses just to learn a few English words.
Oh.
It's helped a lot, too.
So how do you think that experience of being bilingual is going to prepare you to be a teacher? I mean, you're teaching right now, but prepare you to work in the elementary school system?
Well, there's a lot. I know there's a lot of kids that are bilingual that come to school. So just being able to know that they have like a different background experience and be able to kind of relate to like what they are coming from and being able to help them get through their school experience, just like I was helped, you know, get through my second grade experience.
That is seriously just so amazing. I love that. I did not know that about you. So thank you so much for sharing that with us. So moving forward just a little bit, I know we're kind of getting close on time here, but why don't you tell us just a little bit of advice that you would have for anyone who might be in the same position as you, who maybe they just got their associate's degree or they're still in school. Do you have any advice for them?
Well, I took a break, a whole like year off. And people told me, like, oh, you're never going to go back to school. And I was like, if you are dedicated and you are motivated to go back before it's too late, before you get married, before you do any of that stuff and have a kid or whatnot, because you don't know where your life is going to take you. And so I was like, if I have the time right now and I want to go back and start, I'm like, yes, I know I'll be in school for another 2 years, you know, pay more money. But I'm like, it'll be better in the long run. Like, you'll have a job, you'll have like this big community you get to work with. So I'm just saying, like, don't give up, keep going. If you have that little gut feeling that you should go back. Because when you're gonna be like 30, 40, I don't know. I hear people saying, they're like, ah, I should have went back, but I didn't. So I'm glad I went back and I don't regret it yet.
I absolutely love that. So you're a year into your program, right? You said you started in 2019. So you are finishing 2021 or 2022?
2022.
Okay. So you have another year left in your journey. Are you graduating in May or December?
May.
May. Okay. So you have another year left in your journey. And that is so amazing that you're balancing it all. You're going to school full time. You're working full time. You took some time off and you decided to go back to school. And even going through it now, balancing it during a pandemic, you're still like, yep, it was totally worth it. So I'm so excited for you and your journey. And I know there is just truly going to be so much goodness that's going to come out of this. And your students are going to seriously, I mean, your students that you have right now are so lucky to have you, but all of the future students that you're going to have as well, just your kind heart and your understanding, it's just amazing. So before we go, I know you've been doing conscious discipline with your students. Would you mind just touching a little bit on that?
Yeah. So I was saying that, like, I personally, when I started at the preschool center, I didn't know what it was. I was like, we had to teach conscious discipline. Like, what is this? But our center required us to do 10 hours, I think, worth of watching videos. This lady would talk. I forget her name. But we had, like, this whole program. My director bought it. And we were all given, like, a password to log on. And we're like, okay, perfect. We can do this. And I would watch, like, an hour or so, maybe 2 hours worth of it a week. And then we had, like, these questions at the end due to answer. But, like, they were really good because – now in my mornings, I incorporate conscious discipline. Like, I would start my morning with, like, a school family song. So we unite everybody together. And then the next thing that we did was we do, like, a little I love you ritual. So, like, anything that gets the kids interacting. Like, one of the things, like, they love to do is, like, we can't do it right now with, you know, touching hands and whatnot, but they do it on their own body. So, like, they hold their hand and, like, there was a little mouse. He had a little house and he lived right. And they find the neck and they tickle themselves. And it just makes them laughing, giggling. And then once we do that, we do, like, a breathing, any kind of breathing exercise. So we'll do, like, maybe we'll do the balloon breath. Your hands on your head, inflate the balloon, deflate the balloon. Or we will do, like, you know, blow out the birth, smell a flower, blow out the birthday candle. And I'm like, we're going to do it 3 times because you guys are 3 years old. And they love it. And they laugh at me more because I'm, like, trying to blow through a mask. And they're like, Miss Rena, you can do it. I was like, yeah, I can. They're like, you're not blowing out the flower. And then I pretend like my fingers just went down as I'm blowing it out. So we do that. And then we do, like, a little calendar thing. But those little things that we do unite the class together. And those are part of the conscious discipline. One of the things is, like, if they ever, somebody gets hurt, like, we have kids that will, you know, push and shove. And before when we started doing this, like, I'm like, how are these kids even going to get this into their mind? But, like, conscious discipline trains them to, like, you see their face. Are they happy? They're like, no. I'm like, are they sad? They're like, yeah, they're sad. Like, or they can see a tear going down their face. I'm like, okay, so what does that tell you? And they're like, they're hurt? Or they'll sometimes, like, if they won't answer, you give them the words to say. They're like, they look hurt. And, like, just putting the words into their mouths. And, like, by the end of the school year, they were always like, so-and-so hit my body and I did not like it. Can you help me? Or then, and you'll come over, like, can you say sorry? I won't do that again. It was an accident. Or, like, you know, just moving on. And by the end of the school year, like, my kids now are in different classrooms. I'll be walking down the hall and they're like, hey, I don't like it when you hit my body. I'm like, hey, they learned. They're, like, in their head and they're doing it. So I'm like, it works somehow. Like, sometimes, like, you forget and you're like, hey, don't do that. And you're like, wait, I see that you're frustrated. I see that you weren't want to ask me a question, but can you just wait 1 second while I'm helping this student? And, like, being able to do that and, like, even driving in the car, you're like, okay, it's okay. I left late. It's my own fault. I'm not going to yell at this other car. Or, you know, if you have somebody in the car with you, like, don't take it out on anybody else. So, like, it's like an everyday thing. You see it everywhere now. I'm like people even ask me, like, about their own kids too. They're like, how can I do that? Like, do you see that school behavior at school? And I'm like, because I babysit for a few of the kids and they're like, help me instill that conscious discipline inside of them so they can do that at home too. And I was like, yeah, okay, I'll practice that.
That is so awesome. And I love how you just said that. I was just going to ask you, how does that relate to when you're out in the real world and when you're babysitting? And that's perfect. I love that you're able to take what you're learning in the classroom and apply it to everything else, because so much of what we do as teachers truly does apply to everything else that we do in our quote unquote real world lives. Yeah. Well, Irina, I have seriously loved having you on the podcast today. I think so many of the listeners are really going to enjoy the things that you had to say, especially about you being bilingual. That is seriously so neat. And I love that you still talk in Ukrainian at home too. But before we go today, is there anything else you want to share with anyone?
I'm just really happy that you had me and I was able to share my experience with everyone. And I hope I can, like, you know, reach out to other people and be able, you know, to relate to other people who ever had the same issues or anything that with me. I'm like, I don't know. It's a whole journey and I'm just beginning all over again to get my bachelor's. So it's like a whole learning process all over again.
Definitely. So if anyone wants to reach out to you, how can they find you?
They can find me on Facebook. Not Facebook, Instagram. I have a teacher's page. It's called The Learning Boat. And I've been posting different content on there right now. It's all preschool related right now. And I've had a few parents actually reach out to me. They're like, hey, can you post more things about this and this? Like, they're like, we're trying to find some more circle songs. Or we're trying to find more things at home because a lot of parents are still kept their kids at home. And like, these are parents I've never met in my life. So I'm just like, okay, I'm reaching some people, you know, on my Instagram page. But sooner or later, I hope to like branch out more once I get into kindergarten, first or second, wherever I end up teaching and having different content on there as well.
Oh, definitely. I love that. So it's at The Learning Boat. If you want to reach out to Irina, I know she would love to chat with you, get to know you more, and offer you any advice that she can. So thank you again so much for being here today. If you guys have any questions whatsoever, feel free to reach out to us. And if not, thank you so much for listening to today's episode. We're so thankful that you're here.
Thank you so much for listening to this episode of the North Dakota Teaching Podcast. If you're enjoying the show, please feel free to rate, subscribe, and leave a review wherever you listen to your podcasts. We really appreciate that effort. Be sure to tune in to the next episode for more teaching tips to make an impact. Until next time.